Welcome back to Nightcast. It is a small change that police say would have a big impact on keeping guns out of the hands of potentially dangerous people. Police chiefs want more discretion when it comes to granting permits to purchase guns. Investigative reporter Eric Rasmussen has been talking to key stakeholders in Minnesota ever since that shooting at the Allina clinic in Buffalo last month, Eric.
Paul, the question was, how did the suspect get a handgun despite a history of alleged threats and a previous finding of mental incompetence to stand trial? Now, five investigates confirmed Buffalo police issued Gregory Ulrich what's known as a permit to purchase. But their hands may have been tied, and we've found that now has both gun control and gun rights advocates talking about what can be changed.
And we are tracking breaking news tonight out of Buffalo.
A frustratingly familiar headline.
A 67-year-old man is in custody.
A suspected shooter prompting the same questions.
I think it's clear that this is somebody who intended to cause harm and who should not have had a weapon.
But possibly not clear enough for Buffalo police to have denied the suspect what's known as a permit to purchase a firearm.
A law enforcement source has confirmed to five investigates that Gregory Ulrich bought that gun legally.
I guess my mind always goes to, it seems like they're preventable.
Former Bloomington Police Chief Jeff Potts says departments have to follow specific rules when deciding who can legally buy a gun, run a criminal background check, and check a state database of those who've been civilly committed to treatment for mental illness.
If they are not, the department shall issue the permit to purchase within 7 days.
Now the executive director of the Minnesota Chiefs of Police Association, Potts, and others want to change that.
The proposal make the process for a permit to purchase work more like a permit to carry here in Minnesota. Instead of 7 days, sheriffs have 30 days to process a carry permit. And there's also some not so small print giving sheriffs a bit of discretion that police don't have. They can deny a permit if there's a substantial likelihood that the applicant is a danger to self or the public.
That language would be helpful in the permit to purchase because we know there are situations that have not yet met the judicial commitment level that create a significant risk.
Just like in Buffalo, five investigates reported police first had concerns after Ulrich was accused of threatening a mass shooting in 2018.
In his report, the officer flagged this behavior, saying, "I believe Ulrich is a high threat to society and himself."
But under current law, that alone would not have been enough to deny Ulrich a permit to purchase a gun.
If the police chiefs and sheriffs want the ability to have some discretion on that, there needs to be a high level of accountability to make sure that they are not unduly restricting somebody's right to own a firearm.
Rob Doerr is the political director for the Minnesota Gun Owners Caucus. He says he's open to a conversation about small changes to the laws around gun permits, but he says Gregory Ulrich should have already been prevented from having a gun ever since he was found mentally incompetent to stand trial in a misdemeanor case last year.
He was a prohibited person based on being unfit to stand for trial. So what information is retained, who retains it, and where it goes, I think are all good questions to ask.
As we told you last month, it appears Gregory Ulrich's case fell through the cracks when a prosecutor dismissed the case instead of a judge. Without a judge ruling that Ulrich was mentally incompetent, police may have had to issue him a permit even if they knew about his history. And that's why some police departments want more discretion.
I just want to make sure we get it right.
Nick Newton is a captain with Oakdale Police.
There's typically a misconception that we have this big database that we punch someone's name into. It'll tell us if this person should have a permit or they should not. When in reality, is all that criminal background does is tell us if there's any potential disqualifiers we should look into.
And they only have 7 days to find those disqualifiers. Newton says that can be a tall task, considering his department processed 540 permit-to-purchase applications last year, more than 10 a week.
That can be difficult for us sometimes if we, for example, look at our local records and see something that may be of concern to us but doesn't really meet the threshold for disqualifying factor.
We always talk about this loophole or that loophole. Our current gun laws in Minnesota were designed to be Swiss cheese.
Longtime gun control advocate Nancy Nord-Bentz says the shooting in Buffalo motivated her to form a new nonprofit called Gun Safe Minnesota. Its goals go beyond changing gun permit laws.
If we had had stronger, better, safer laws in this state, This tragedy certainly could have been prevented, but no one law will do that.
But police say it's a start.
And where we see there may be ways to make some what I think are fairly minor changes, that we need to pursue those, because at the again, it's our duty to go out there and try to keep our community safe from people who may be interested in doing harm.
At last check, there is no current bill pending that would specifically change the law around gun permits, but the Chiefs Association told me elements of that proposal have been part of the group's legislative agenda in the past. Now, Paul, another point of contention here, the Chiefs also want to be able to charge a fee for processing those permits to purchase. That's the same way sheriffs do right now for carry permits. In fact, they're on the hook for legal fees if someone takes them to court and wins.
Mm. Well, Eric, it's pretty clear that the rules need to be looked at when you listen to everything that they had to say. Eric Rasmussen, thank you very much.